Fritz Montana. Brought to you by Stockman Bank. Montana Banking, pure and simple. BNSF Railway. We live here, we work here, and we're proud of it. Taylor's Auto Group, where everything we do for you. Billings, Montana's trailhead. Plan your stay at visitbillings.com.
Oh, we hope you enjoy this episode of That's Montana as much as we enjoyed making it. We had a chance to visit with legendary blues musician Dale Renee. But first, we talked to Tim Goodridge. Tim is the organizer of the Magic City Blues Festival. It's going to celebrate its 10th anniversary this summer in Billings. He talks about it, music, and Dale Renee. Tim, Montana. Most people, I think, as far as music is concerned, would think country western. But that's not the case with the event that you put together. Kind of give us an idea what goes on music-wise, not only in Billings, but across the state.
Well, I think we've seen a real change over the years in what people want to listen to here, and part of it is because so many people have transplanted to Montana from all over the state. I mean, we're a very desirable place to live because you don't have all the craziness that accompanies metropolitan city living. And so as a result of that, you know, you have people who have a lot of different tastes anymore. It's not just the simple country music stuff. And then our economy's diversified so much, and you know, the generations have come. We're still, country still rules in Montana, but there's a healthy undercurrent of other music going on.
One of the people that is part of this program that we'll see is Dale Renee. Mm-hmm. And he said he got here kind of by the railroad, working for the railroad. Well, how do you see that, and how do you see him? I'm sure you're familiar with him.
Oh yeah, I am. And actually, I first met Dale back in the 80s. Because that was my first introduction to music promotion when I was going to Rocky Mountain College here. And we used to promote shows at the Northern Hotel and in the Carlin down the street here too. But Dale, the first time that I heard him was at Casey's Golden Pheasant, and he used to be there every Monday on the open jam playing.
I was pretty amazed watching Dale play the guitar, because it seemed like as he started, he just kind of went somewhere. He was still here physically, but the music and the mood and everything. Do you get that same feeling, or how do you look at him?
Oh, I do, and I still remember the first time that I saw him play, and I don't remember what the name of it was at that point in time, but it's the little casino that's out on the south side of Grand Avenue, just probably two or three blocks before you get to 24th Street intersection right there. And that was one of the first places that we started doing blues shows in mm-hmm. Billings. You know, maybe seats 100 people or something like that. And he was sitting in with a bunch of local guys. And at that point in time, you could really see the level of musicianship and how much more advanced he was than some of the other guys that he was playing with. And it was just amazing. I think he was playing bass at that point in time. I mean, he was a fabulous player, good singing voice too. And then the other thing that was fun about him is he had connections all over the country with a lot of big-time blues artists. So, you know, we would bring some of those guys into town, like John Lee Hooker and James Cotton, and Dale would show up and he would know these guys and be chit-chatting with them in the green room. So it was really fun, and it's just odd all the time to think that somebody like him would end up in a place like Billings, Montana.
Then you decided to put together a show of your own.
Right, that was when we moved back here, because in the intervening years, I'd gotten married and moved up to Vancouver, British Columbia, and then the children were getting old enough to start school, and we decided that we wanted to come back and relocate to Montana again, the same thing that I had told you earlier, which a lot of people do. And when we got back here, we've always been self-employed, and so when you move, you gotta figure out how to eat. And so we decided, one night I was sitting right over here at the beanery around their fire pit. And it was about 10 o'clock at night in July or August. This was 2001, the first year that we were back. And I was looking around and it was kind of quiet and there weren't a lot of cars coming down Montana Avenue. And I thought, wow, you know, this would be a cool place to have a music festival. And that's how it all begins. And then, you know, from there, you got to get the approvals, you got to get people excited about it, you got to get the bands. And this is going to be our 10th anniversary this year, so it's just amazing to me that it all starts out from silly little moments like that.
That's true. But now you've also expanded.
Yes.
You're going to be doing something quite a bit different than doing it on the street when we get into August of this coming summer.
Yeah, we're really excited about this whole part of it. It's an expansion into South Park. And the reason that we wanted to do that is because it's during the daytime. And during the daytime in Montana in August, it's typically pretty warm. And so being out on the street is not the most opportune place to be. So we wanted to have grass and trees. And South Park is this beautiful park in Billings that's really underutilized. And I don't think most people who live here have even been there, let alone know that it exists. So it's kind of a fun little hidden away spot. And that's one of the things that's exciting about doing these kind of events is up until we closed Montana Avenue and had the first Magic City Blues Festival here, I don't think anybody ever could have envisioned how this would transform. And it's going to be the same way at South Park too. And that's part of the fun thing about doing these is surprising people and giving them something that's different than the way that they envisioned it happening.
Tell us about some of the folks you've got lined up for this year's event.
Oh yeah, we're very excited. Like I said, this is our 10th anniversary. And so what we've done for the shows on Montana Avenue, which are the night shows, has brought back basically the most requested acts that we've had over the years. And the one that people have loved the most and wanted to come back the most is George Thorogood and the Destroyers. Mm-hmm. And they're gonna be on Friday, August 12th. And then on Saturday, August 13th, we've got Michael Franti and Spearhead. And they were a band that played last year, which is really odd for us to bring back a band 2 years in a row, but he just manages to create this atmosphere around his music that elevates the performance beyond simply music, and it's people just love that. And so we want to bring him back and participate in that again. And then down at South Park, we have Hanson that's going to be playing on Saturday, and that's going to be a really fun family event. We're going to have the range from grandmas to babies down there, all kinds of fun activities. And then on Sunday, it's going to be more of a gospel tinge to it. And we're going to have the whole festival closed by the Chicago Mass Choir, which is a 50-person African-American choir based in Chicago. And it's just amazing, the power that comes out of that choir. They have a soloist out front and a band. And it's just, it's going to be one of the most tremendous things that happens all weekend.
Neighborhood's going to be moving, huh?
Oh, it really is. It really is. I can't wait to see that, because I think, for me, that's going to be my highlight of the weekend.
When we come back, we'll introduce you to blues legend Dale Renee.
This is the engine that connects abundant grain from the American heartland to Aaron's best-selling whole wheat while keeping 60 billion pounds of carbon out of the atmosphere every year. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
This is the engine that connects zero-emission technologies to breathing a little easier while taking 4.6 million truckloads off the road every year. BNSF, the engine that connects us.
Get ready to be impressed. Blues legend Dale Renee tells us a little bit of his background. He's been around the world, played with some of the greatest musicians in the world as well, came to Billings in 1977, and most recently, about the last 5 years, has teamed up with So Ito, a fellow you're gonna meet as well. So Dale, tell us who's who of folks that you've played with down through the years.
Jan Brown, B.B. King, Jenny Reed, Big Mama Thornton, Joy Smith, G. Nichols, Philip Walker, I guess name all of them, but it's on and on and on. Don Johnson, he's the one with the drummer from the Taste of Honey. They started that group in my front room, my house in L.A.
So obviously, a lot of years, a lot of work, and now you're in Billings, Montana, and have been for some time. Give us a little of the trail that you followed to get here.
Well, I came out here from Buffalo, New York, after I grew up in Hamilton. And I got back to Buffalo, New York. I said, I'm going to stop playing. I'm sick of this. I stayed about 3 years playing over there because the agent sold my contract over there, so we couldn't come back. We had to do something here. So I came back over here to the States. I'm not going to leave this place. I'm going to stay in the United States and see what happened. I started working for Penn Central up there in Memphis. So when Penn Central started going bankrupt back there some years back, so they transferred all the engineers out. Jimmy Marks sent me off out here, turned around and bent over. Said, I'm going to get rid of that big map on the wall. It's throwing dark where you go. That's where you're picking where you're going. And just, well, I want to go and go ahead. There's no argument like that. You know? So I took the tape and God put it behind. I can get rid of you. Did like that, and then look. Right in the middle of not Montana, middle of Billings. Yeah, we laughed about it, you know. I came out here once when the Skyliner Club was on the rims up there.
Oh.
Buck Anderson, I came out here and played out there. Me and a guy named Russ Miskin, he's passed away, bless his soul. Willa Black, and Emerson Carruthers, and John Pitcher was on drums, and I played bass. And we used to come in for 2 weeks and we got here from November to the last of February. That's the one that kept us up there. Mm-hmm. So when I left there, I went back to L.A. So I'm not, no, I'm tired. I'm going to go with that snow. So I got raised around L.A., you know. I told him, I said, don't you say you didn't like snow? I don't care much for it. How do you always wind up in it every time you say you're not going? I don't know, maybe snow just to draw me to it, you know. So I came out here in November in 77. And every time I came out here in November. Hmm. I came out here in November to Skyline Club, and I stayed until the last of February. I came out here in November, in 77 in November. I got out here the 19th of November. I got out here the 19th of November up there at Skyline Club. Well, no family or nothing now. You know, I'm a single man, put in. Got out here and I started working at the railroad out here. So B.B. King had me come into town. And he is a friend of mine named Jim Marte. And he told him, hey, big man, well, you got a big old beard, big old hammer and organ in you. You play it? See, I play it. Can you read it? Yeah, I think I have some pay much, you can't play it. And I guess so. He said, BB's in town, we're going to give a party. Cases that just opened up.
Oh, downtown?
Yeah, across the post office on 26th Street. I said, man, he said, they're going to have a party for BB. I said, I used to play with BB. Oh, you kidding? No, I'm not kidding. I get down there. I said, I don't know, man. I said, I was going to play tomorrow. And right back in the same trend. I got away from it. I've been fighting for about a year. I got away. I'm good now. I said, leave me alone. He said, man, come on, just this tackle. I promise I get somebody to play or do a party for him. I said, okay. Get out there, start playing. And BB walked in the door at the church, someplace up here, this army base up here.
Oh, the National Guard.
Yeah, had up there at that place there. And he walked in the door out of there. Bob Britton, another guy, was there. Jack Janice, he's from about the reservation out there. Bob Britton from New Jersey, and I met him down at the pawn shop. He looking at some guitars. I walked in one day and looked around and seen him, and I said, the three of us got together. I saw the jam session here, Casey, in 1985. Mm-hmm. But anyway, I just get away from music, wind up back in some kind of way. So I said I wasn't gonna play no more, and I wind up playing 22 more years.
From the top down, we feel that customer satisfaction is derived from employee satisfaction, and we go to great lengths to see that our employees are satisfied and so that our customers are as well. We want people to feel comfortable when they walk in the door, that we go at their pace, and that they get all the information that they need to make an informed decision. And we wouldn't be what we are today without the loyal repeat business that we have and continually have, day in, day out, month in and month out.
Don't go away. That's Montana. We'll be right back. Kind of an unusual combination, American, Japanese, bass, guitar, I mean, all the rhythm and everything here, and then You went to school at Rocky in Billings.
Yes, that's correct.
Then give us a quick rundown of your musical background and then how you wound up with this character.
Okay, well, actually, during the college time, I played with the local musicians, and we tried to play rock and roll type of thing. But anyway, I thought a friend of mine doing like a open mic night session at the Casey's back then. Mm-hmm. So I thought I was going to see them. But I came down, that was a Monday night. And then this Dale was playing on stage, playing bass guitar. Uh-huh. And so I was like, oh my God, he's good. And so I went to talk to him after he played, and then he asked me, where are you from? And so I'm from Tokyo, Japan. And so he said, well, I went to Tokyo to play music. And where was it? Shibuya. The Shibuya was about 20 minutes away from my parents' house. It's pretty much my hometown. So we kept talking, and then found out even he played with my music star, Jimi Hendrix. And so I was like, oh my God, I gotta do something. And I gotta learn from him. And ever since I started learning from him, and I hope I'll be his last student still, you know.
Great.
You teaching nobody either.
Okay. Well, I'll tell you what. Like, yeah.
Like, no, I ain't teaching nobody. I'm going to learn play. Because, man, you don't teach anybody. You know, I don't want to teach anybody. You kept on. I said, okay.
Amazing.
I said, be over there Sunday at 12 o'clock. So don't be late at 12 o'clock.
And it's paid off. Yeah. Obviously, music, universal language.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Bring us together. Let's play something and see what happens when you two get together.
Just a building. It's a refuge from the outside world, a place where families can feel safe and secure. At Stockman Bank, we enjoy helping Montanans build and own their own homes. And we treat borrowers like friends and neighbors, because they are. Treating people with respect, care, and a personal touch is the Montana way. It's the only way we know. Stockman Bank. Montana banking, pure and simple.
Montana for you.
Guys, it used to be in the old days where you played a gig somewhere, and see, I know music talk, okay? But you played a night's worth of music, you were tired, but you got in a vehicle and you drove who knows how far somewhere else to do the same thing the next night.
Very true, very true.
Well, now, in this modern age of technology, it sounds like soul has come across a way to where you can play to your heart's content, but you don't have to travel.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, about 3 years ago, found out program called StickCam, which is live stream. And so we tried to do this internet show, which is called Dale and Saul Blues Show. And we tried to do it every Friday and afternoon, three times. 3 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 9 o'clock.
And the reason for that?
Well, there's a reason for that, because 3 o'clock, around 10 o'clock British time, European people can watch us. And 6 o'clock, actually 4 o'clock, New York time, and 8 o'clock, LA time. And then 9 o'clock, we hit the Japanese lunchtime, which is 9 o'clock our time. That's a 12 o'clock noon their time. So we could kind of cover that all over the world, over one day to doing the show. And back then, you know, it was pretty new. Later on, we found out, you know, doing chat or text message could give us a lot of ideas. You know, hopefully we can do something like that again, and to get more communicate with a lot of people from all over the world.
Tell us, we've got a big history with this fella.
Yes.
How'd you get started in music, and what brought you to Billings?
Well, actually, I was attending to Temple University in Philadelphia first. And then the president of Temple University offered me come to Rocky Mountain College, Billings, Montana, or Huron University in South Dakota. Mm. And so I asked him which one is not colder. And so he said, Billings, Montana, Rocky Mountain College. And, okay. I'm going. And then 1992, I came here, and it was August, middle of August, and then, you know, dry, hot. In Japan, very high, humid, hot. Mm-hmm. And so I was like, oh my God, here's a heaven. And then bright until 10 o'clock nighttime. Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow, thank you. You know, this is the best place to study English. And until later for the January and February and the winter time. So basically that's why I came here. And then ever since, I cannot live here. That's Montana, you know? And I think the Montana has some power, you know, like special power.
You don't drink the water.
Oh, yeah.
You drink the water, you won't leave.
The special power, you know, just
You told him that?
No, they told me that all anyway.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah, I was transferred out here to work at Burlington Northern. I was put back in just 2 years. Mm-hmm. That's in 77. Uh-huh. And I came out here in November in 77. Mm-hmm. It is November again.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank both of you for this opportunity that we have shared, and we'll be back to see you some more and listen to you.
Okay.
And thank if you don't mind, play us a little Montana tune, if you got one stashed away.
Montana Blues, huh?
That's a wrap on this episode of That's Montana. We want to thank Dale Renee, So Ito, and Tim Goodridge for sharing with us some of the magic of music. And don't forget, you can visit our website at www.thatsmontana.com or join us on Facebook. See you next Sunday.
That's Montana has been brought to you by Stockman Bank, Montana Banking Pure and Simple. BNSF Railway. We live here, we work here, and we're proud of it. Taylor's Auto Group, where everything we do for you. Billings, Montana's trailhead. Plan your stay at visitbillings.com.